The Bisan Lecture Series is a new series of monthly webinars which aim at the full integration of Palestine into the global learning community.
We sponsor discourses on subjects of cultural, scientific, and societal importance by leading research experts and public intellectuals of varied heritage and viewpoints.
These interactive webinars are free and open to the public, and recordings of each will be posted soon after the end of each lecture.
The Bisan Center for Research and Development is a non-partisan civil society organization that was founded back in 1989. We work on connecting young scholars with the global community of research to contribute to the creation and establishment of these connections and this community of learning, where sciences of all forms can be used and utilized for the benefit of man.
The Bisan Lecture Series is the response of the international academic community to the Israeli attacks against the inalienable right of the Palestinian people to education and academic freedom. We stand in solidarity with the six Palestinian NGOs targeted by the Israeli government, and through them, with the entirety of Palestinian civil society.
Welcome all. Ahlan wa marhaban bikum ayna ma kuntum. I am Asaf Fouri, a theoretical computer scientist at Boston University in the United States, and a member of the steering committee of BLS, the Bisan Lecture Series. Today's webinar is the first session of our 2022-2023 season, which is the second season of BLS. There will be 8 monthly sessions, typically in the second Wednesday of every month, and today will be the first one of this season. Our guest speaker is Professor Salim Tamari, and it will be my pleasure to introduce him and say a few words to put his scholarly work in context. Before I do this, I have to draw attention to the exceptionally difficult circumstances which one of the two founding organizations of BLS is going through right now. BLS, the Bisan Lecture Series, is a joint project of two groups, Scientists for Palestine and the Bisan Center for Research and Development. Of the two, Scientists for Palestine is international with members in many countries in Europe and North America, which gives it a measure of protection from governments that want to do it harm. The other group, the Bisan Center, is based in Ramallah in occupied Palestine and is therefore directly in harm's way. The Bisan Center has been constantly harassed by the Israeli authorities. Its executive director, Ubay Aboudi, was detained for several months 2 years ago and later threatened with detention again. In October of 2021, the Israeli Defense Minister, Benny Gantz, designated the Bisan Center and 5 other organizations of Palestinian civil society terrorist organizations. The manifest intent of the bogus designation was to outlaw the Bisan Center and the 5 other groups, which would allow the Israeli military to raid their offices, seize their assets, arrest their employees, and criminalize funding and cooperation, including expression of support. And this is exactly what happened this past August 18. Before I go back to my introduction for Salim, I let Ubay, who is also a member of the steering committee of BLS, to say a few words about the threats and difficulties he and his center are now facing. Uba, your turn.
Sorry. Thank you, Asaf, and thank you, Salim, and the BLS Bisan Lecture Series Steering Committee. The Bisan Center, along with other six Palestinian civil society organizations, were raided on the 19th of August. Our offices were ransacked, our equipment stolen, laptops, desktops, cameras, photocopiers, our documents were stolen, and the Israeli occupation forces declared our premises closed and our organizations as not allowed to work. This follows the declaration of our organizations as terrorist organization by the Israeli Minister of Defense, Benny Gantz, which has declared not just the six organizations as terrorists, but also has outlawed our work according to a military order. According to the lawyers of the organizations, there is no legal path to challenge this left in the Israeli judicial system, where they are rubber stamping the decisions and saying that they are doing this under secret evidence. But what is left for us actually as organizations is international solidarity, putting pressure on decision makers globally to help the Palestinian, not just only these seven organizations, but also the broader Palestinian civil society to survive the Israeli repression. Our organizations are open and working. We have vowed to continue our work even if we were arrested and put in Israeli prisons. We have also vowed, even if we were arrested, that we will open in the prisons cells in the names of prison cells in the names of the organizations. Our staff are steadfast and are facing this great repression with heads held high. And what we are saying now to the world is that the Palestinian civil society is resisting brute military force with the power of logic, humanity, and human rights values that we are spreading around the world. So all of this solidarity from the steering committee, from the supporting organizations, is much appreciated. And we see the Bisan Lecture Series as the continuation of the legacy of the organization in spreading critical thought around the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Ubay. I'm going to go back to my introduction for Salim. I'll start with a personal note. Salim and I have been friends since our days as university students. So for more than half a century, I've closely followed his intellectual progression, first out of friendship, but then increasingly out of a fascination for his ability to mine old, mostly unknown or ignored documents and diaries, and then flesh out their wider sociological and historical significance. In today's lecture, I hope you'll get a small taste of that. Salim Tamari is a senior fellow of the Institute of Palestine Studies, the former director of its affiliated Ramallah-based Institute of Jerusalem Studies, the editor of Jerusalem Quarterly, a member of the editorial board of the Journal of Palestine Studies, and a professor of sociology at Birzeit University. Salim has written many articles and books on the social history of Palestine, including, I purposely read some of the titles, but it will give you a sense of his subject matter: Photography and Displaced History of Palestine, published in 2018. The Storyteller of Jerusalem, published in 2014. Years of the Locust, Palestine and Syria During World War I, in 2010. Ihsan's War, The Intimate Life of an Ottoman Soldier, in Arabic, 2008. And in English, 2015, which he translated himself, by the way, from Arabic to English. The Mountain and the Sea, in 2008. And other writing. Salim was born in 1945 in the city of Jaffa, Palestine, which his family had to flee during the 1948 Arab-Israeli War, eventually taking refuge in the hinterland city of Ramallah. He completed his doctoral studies in sociology at Manchester University in the UK and has held visiting positions in several universities in Europe and North America over the years. Not long ago, I'll conclude with a short paragraph here. Not long ago, a famous prime minister who is glorified in the West and especially in the United States said, there's no such thing as Palestinians. Her interviewer listened to her with awed reverence. There was no pushback from any official quarter. At best, perhaps some muted embarrassment at her crude racism and disdain for her surrounding reality. Well, a good place to start to debunk such vile and trashy nonsense is Salim's work. If you have a chance to read some of his writings, you will discover a living and organic society with all its cultural norms and peculiarities, with tension between coast and mountain, between urban and rural, and between classes. And all of that at the turn of the last century, and well before there was something called the State of Israel. No, there is such thing as Palestinian. Before I turn the stage to Salim, I'd like to explain how this webinar is organized. Salim will speak for about 40, 45 minutes. After that, there'll be a 20, 25 minutes for question and answer. At any time you have a question, you can enter them into the chat box. You have to go to the bottom of the Zoom window and you will see an icon that says chat. You have to go to that and write your question. You can write it in English or in Arabic. In relation to the Arabic, I should say that if you go to the bottom of the Zoom window, there is a globe, and under it you will see interpretation. You can click on that and you will be able to hear the whole lecture in Arabic. And so if you wish, you can also have the question into the chat box in Arabic. At the end of the lecture, I'll read them verbally for Salim, and I'll translate also myself, and then Salim will answer to the question. Salim, it's your stage now.
Thank you, dear Asaf, for this embarrassing introduction. I think we can move to the questions now. Since thank you for having me on this fine evening, and to the Bisan group, which are my neighbors in Ramallah. I have chosen a theme that may sound esoteric to some of you, but I think it's very much related to what's going on today, which is the great transformations brought in by war in the identity, social construction, and trajectories of Palestine through the media of biographic and autobiographic writings. So since I have a few images and photos and maps to show you, I will move to the share screen if I can manage to find it.
You're okay, we see you, yes.
All righty. Yeah. Maybe we should skip that because I can't find the PowerPoint.
At the bottom of your Zoom screen.
Okay.
You see the green button, share screen.
Share screen, but where is it? I'll find it. Eventually, I'll find it. Desktop for you. Maybe I should. Shall I go to the? Can you give me the PowerPoint from your side?
Okay, so you would like us to show the PowerPoint on our side, and then
maybe I.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Can you see it now?
You have to, yes. We see your screen. Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. Okay, the theme of, can you all see the PowerPoint on your screen?
Yes.
Great. I start by the whole tradition in Arabic historiography known as tarajim and tabaqat, which is a very old tradition of autobiographical and biographical lexicons, which evolved into the system of tarajim, in which scholars, jurists, politicians, military commanders used to have their biographies written. And from those, we cull a great deal of interpretation of social history. The modern autobiographical tradition in the Arab world is evolving from this, and the most recently, the whole question of modern fictional autobiography, which is a disguised literary genre that gives freedom to the author to break social taboos. It belongs to a classic genre that can be compared to and includes Taha Hussein's Al-Ayyam, Al-Khubz Al-Hafi by Muhammad Shukri, and most importantly, the first modern autobiography by Ahmed Faris Shidyaq, which was published in France in 1855 under the title of Saq ala Saq. Shidyaq's autobiography was the first and most ambitious in this genre. The use of fictional characters and third-person narratives gave these authors a domain of freedom and distancing mechanism, which allowed them to enhance the dialogue and dramatize the events in a manner not witnessed before. The reader enters a secret compact with the author, which suspends disbelief and allows the author to reconstruct the events of the war for the benefit of the present onlooker and with the benefit of hindsight. We call these self-writing, and self-writing in times of war is the subject of our discussion this evening, or in your case, this morning, I suppose. The Great War, which was fought between 1914 and 1918, produced a surprisingly large number of diaries and memoirs that reflected the anguish, uncertainty, and the search for a new identity in the post-Ottoman period. The authors were journalists, officers, teachers, musicians, artisans, mostly middle class and aristocratic people. But in one case, for Palestine, we have the diary of an ordinary soldier, Hassan Turjman, whose diary I published under the title of Year of the Locust. All of those people produced a vision of a new world that was emerging in Greater Syria in the post-Ottoman era. In Mifleh al-Ghassani, we have a pioneering work of modernist autobiography. It was published by, it was actually written during the war and published immediately after the war by the journalist Najib Nassar, and its style is reminiscent of the work of John Dos Passos, utilizing reportage, formal documentation, and subjective observation in the construction of fictional narratives. Mifleh al-Ghassani belongs to the genre of the autobiographical novel pioneered by Shidyaq and his modernist masterpiece, As-Saq al-Saq. We also have a riveting autobiographical work, not published yet, actually. I have written about it, but it's not published, by the historian Arif al-Arif. This was the Siberian diary of a Jerusalem war prisoner who spent the war years in a Russian encampment. Arif Shahadi was captured in the Battle of Ard al-Rum in northern Anatolia in August 1915, and he spent the bulk of the war in Siberia, in the war camp. He published, during the incarceration, Arif published a prisoner handwritten war newspaper, which he called Naqatullah, or God's Camel. And you see, we are very lucky to have one single issue of that war paper. You can see that the subscription cost 1 ruble for a whole year and 60 copics for half a year, and each issue can be bought for 3 copics. This is a joke, of course, because this was a wallpaper that's hanging on the wall, and is described as a satirical literary journal published once a year. The war itself, which led to this incarceration, was fought between the Ottomans and the German allies and the Austrians on the one hand, and the Western allies of France, Italy, Britain, of course, on the other. The four corners of the battles were the Dardanelles, where Gallipoli was fought, in Palestine front along the Suez Canal and the Beersheba region in the south. And in the east, it was fought in Kut al-Amara and the Basra region in Baghdad, south of Baghdad. And of course, in the northern part between Russia and the Anatolia, in the Ardur Rum region, where Arif was captured in August 1915. This was the period which led to the evolution of imperial schemes to control the Arab East, Greater Syria, by the Allies after what they suspected, and they correctly assessed that they will defeat the Ottomans and their allies. So in this we have a British and French conflicting commitments made to the Arabs and of the Arabs and against the Arabs. The first was the promise of independence given to Sharif Hussein of Mecca in return for Arab collaboration against the Ottomans. And then we have the ill-fated Balfour Declaration, which was published, issued in 1917, committing Britain to the idea of a Jewish state in Palestine. But most importantly, there was a secret agreement known as Sykes-Picot, secretly agreed on by Italy, Tsarist Russia, Britain, and France to divide the Middle East between the four powers at the time. And it ended up with a Franco-British secret alliance to divide the bulk of Iraq and Greater Syria between the two colonial powers. Memoirs and diaries present us with a valuable window to the tempo of daily life during the war. Soldiers' diaries were written in the heat of the moment and differ significantly from retrospective memoirs of politicians and public intellectuals. They reveal a perspective that is often missing from the filtered wisdom of reflections written several decades after the event. Most importantly, they compel us to question the assumptions of nationalist rewriting of history in the case of the post-Ottoman mandate and the mandate rule over Syria, Palestine, Lebanon, and Jordan. Of the people I'm going to discuss today, I'm going to focus to some extent on the writings of Muhammad Kurd Ali and his 5-volume memoirs. Muhammad Kurd Ali is a Damascene scholar of Kurdish Circassian origins. He came from Sulaymaniyah region in northern Iraq. And he published before the war one of the most important journals, newspapers in the Arab East, Al-Muqtabas. And Muqtabas was probably the most influential, the most respected, and the most censored daily in the Hamidian period. His partner was Shukri al-Asali, who was hanged by Ahmed Jamal's military tribunals in Alay in 1916, in both in the Burj region of Beirut and in the Damascus main square. Kurt Ali was also the founder of the Academy of Arabic Language in Damascus and the author of the encyclopedic work, Khitat al-Sham, a work of magisterial social geography of Syria. During the war, Muhammad Kurd Ali, who was very close to the regime of Jamal Pasha, constructed two commissions to mobilize Arab intellectuals from the Lebanon, Palestine, Transjordan, Syria, and Iraq to support the war effort against secession by the Arab nationalists. Those two volumes were published later as the scientific expedition to the Caliphate, Al-Bi'th al-Ilmiyya ila Dar al-Khilafa al-Islamiyya, and that was a trip expedition to discover the northern part of the Ottoman Empire by the Arab intelligentsia. And the second expedition was organized to the south. It was known as Al-Rihla al-Anwariya al-Asqa' al-Hijaziyya wal-Shamiyya, which was written in honor of Anwar Pasha, second in command of the military Ottoman effort. From these two expeditions, we discover something very important about the nature of identity and identity conflict, which typified the Arab intelligentsia and their divisions in the Arab East. Muhammad Kurd Ali was an enthusiastic champion of the Constitutional Revolution, which ended the despotism of Abd al-Hamid as a member of the CUP, and later in favor of the Party of the Liberal Entente, favoring decentralization and autonomy for Syria within the Ottoman Union. We see that during the war, Muhammad Kurd Ali began to shift his affiliation and his alliances. Initially, Kurd Ali was a main advocate of Osmanlilik, the ideology of integrating the ethnic composition of the Sultanate within an overarching ideology of integration. The point here is, contrary to our retrospective vision of these important writers and intellectuals, the Arab intelligentsia before the war and during the war was highly divided. And a huge section of it actually did favor continuation of the Arab East within the Ottoman constitutional frame, even though many of them, like Muhammad Kurd Ali, favored decentralization. The war strained the relationship between the Ottoman leadership and the Arab intelligentsia, which mainly favored a federal form of decentralism. During the war, Kurd Ali became the editor of Al-Sharq, Jamal Pasha's Damascus newspaper, and an instrument against Arab separatism. The main enemy, as far as the Ottoman leadership was concerned, within the Arab East, was a separatist movement that began to appear in Mount Lebanon, in Damascus, and to a lesser extent, in Palestine and Transjordan. We begin to witness a retreat in the discourse on Islamic, on the ideology of Osmanlilik, that is Ottomanism, or Al-Uthmanliyya in Arabic, and the rise in the use of references to Islam and the unity of the Islamic bond in the Sultanate. Not surprisingly, this discourse on the Islamic core of Ottomanism was also adopted by several Christian intellectuals in Mount Lebanon and Palestine. The most notable of them were Najib Nassar, who edited Al-Karmel, both before the war and after the war, as well as people like Suleiman al-Bustani in Lebanon. In Palestine, Zionism was a factor in dividing the local intelligentsia in their attitude towards the CUP leadership. CUP refers to the Committee of Union and Progress, Al-Ittihad al-Taraqqi. In Nablus and in Jaffa, for example, there was considerable support for the Hamidian restoration. That is, after the overthrow of Sultan Abdul Hamid, the 1908 rebellion, there was considerable support of restoring the despotism of Abdul Hamid. And this, especially among people who were fearing the Young Turks, were exhibiting sympathetic attitudes in favor of Jewish settlement, while the Sultan was stridently opposed to land sales and colonization. We should remember that the expeditions we talked about to Anatolia and to Hejaz, those were organized by Muhammad Kudali on behalf of Jamal and Enver Pashas, including some of the leading religious and secular figures in Bilad al-Sham, all of whom have written some form of memoir or autobiography. This included Sata al-Husari, the very famous educator in Iraq and Syria, As'ad al-Shuqairi, who was the Mufti of the Arab Fourth Ottoman Army, Auni Abdul Hadi from Nablus, Muhammad Izzat Darwazi, probably the most important Palestinian diarist from Nablus also, Sheikh Salim al-Yaqubi, the Mufti of Jaffa, and Ali al-Rimawi, editor of the journal Al-Quds al-Sharif. Many of those became major figures later in the Arab and Syrian national movement. Some, like Yaqubi and Shuqairi, and here I'm talking about As'ad al-Shuqairi, not Ahmed Shuqairi, remained loyal Ottomans in their affinities even after the collapse of the Ottoman Sultanate, and even after Ottomanism was abandoned by the Turks. Crucial to this conflict was the creation of the Syrian Hashemite Alliance. This alliance was important for the success of the Arab rebellion against the Ottomans. It was organized by the British to co-opt the Syrians under Hashemite leadership. It was always fraught with pitfalls, since the main objectives of the Hashemites to secure their succession to the Islamic Caliphate was not the same as that for the Syrian nationalist, which was to secure the independence of Syria from Istanbul. The link between these two objectives was the consensus on Hashemite leadership through the personality of Prince Faisal. Prince Faisal was the common denominator, and he was targeted or designated to be the future king of the independent state of Syria, which of course included at the time all of the states of the current Middle East. What undermined this alliance was the terms of the Sykes-Picot Agreement dividing Syria between France and Britain, and the abandonment of Palestine to the Zionists by the terms of the Balfour Declaration, which neither the Hashemites nor the Syrian nationalists were willing or able to fight, thus abandoning the Palestinians to their own resources. Here we see a picture of Al-Qibla. This is not the case. It's the journal published by Prince Faisal, later King Faisal, to mobilize the journalistic war against the Ottomans. And the Ottomans responded by creating a journal called Al-Sharq, which was edited in Damascus by Muhammad Kudali. So we have Al-Qibla on the one hand and Sharq on the other hand. During this period, Muhammad Kudali produced a large body of how to consolidate the Ottoman identity as a multilingual, multi-ethnic, multinational imperial domain. Kudali was fascinated by the duality of linguistic usage in the border regions. In Tarsus and Adana, I was pleased to note that the majority of inhabitants speak Turkish and Arabic as a matter of daily use, he noted. The best solution for this social linguistic problem is for the Arabs to become Turkified and for Turks to become Arabized. This is inevitable, for Arabic is the tongue of Islam and is immersed in the history of Muslims, while Turkish is the language of politics and administration. It's interesting to see that this was, although it was a rather eccentric view, but it was shared by a large number of the intelligentsia who were involved in this identity conflict during the war. Kurds Ali's authorship of the scientific expedition may well have been an attempt to establish his credentials as an Ottoman loyalist, since he spent years in exile in Cairo after his paper was suspended by the authorities. Years later, he claimed that his work on behalf of Jamal Pasha and the expedition were imposed on him by Asad al-Shuqairi and the Ottoman administration. Today, however, we mourn the demise of Kurd Ali as the last voice who fought for a united Commonwealth of Syria, Egypt, with Anatolia. Another intellectual whose autobiography I'm going to discuss is Rafiq Tamimi from Nablus. Rafiq Tamimi was the author of a very important work called Beirut Vilayati, or Wilayat Beirut, which it's a kind of salnama published in Beirut in 1916. He joined the Fatah al-Arabi, the young Arab youth, in 1919. And during the Palestine War, he became the head of the Najada in Nablus and in Jaffa. So he became a Palestinian nationalist, an Arab nationalist. But during the war, he was known for his authorship of two important works: Wilayat Beirut, which is an encyclopedic work of ethnography, and a less known secret document called Philistine Risalasi, or the Treaties on Palestine. As you can see from this Turkish edition of Wilayat Beirut, it is described as Mushahadat, Geographia, Ethnographia, Tariq, Ahwal, Ruhiyya. These are Turkish words, by the way, not Arabic. And they describe the ethnographic importance of this work. He, as a sociologist who studied in the Sorbonne, he was keen at establishing an ethnographic record of daily life in the region known as the Wilayat Beirut, which included all the area from Latqiyya in the north to Haifa in the south. So Palestine was divided between northern Palestine, which was part of Wilayat Beirut, and southern Palestine, which was Wilayat Mutasarrafiyat al-Quds. And this is sections from his ethnographic notebooks. He also included a very interesting ethnographic map in Philistine Risalasi, which was a military manual, which showed how people looked at the ethnic mapping of the Syrian coast. It was divided not between Arabs and Turks, nor between Muslims and Christians, but rather a combination of ethnic identities and religious communal identities. So people were divided into Turks and Turkmens, Arabs and Syrians, Rumis, and so on. The word Syrian was the word used for sedentarized Arabs, and the word Arab was used as a tribal label for all the people east of the Syrian littoral coast all the way to Iraq. It's a different kind of identity formation that was totally transformed by the war. His work also contributed to redrawing the map of Palestine, excising the northern part of Palestine from the Beirut wilaya and adding it to the southern part of Palestine, creating for the earliest period a military map for Palestine as seen by the Ottoman leadership. The war also produced major divisions concerning how the intelligentsia looked at the future of Syria. In one of the books that Asaf referred to introducing this talk, called Year of the Locust, we see the observation of this soldier, Ihsan al-Turjman, who reflects in his diary the kind of discussion going on within the military brass about the future of Palestine. And in it, we find that one of the major prepositions discussed at the time was that the future will lead to a unity between Khedivian Egypt and southern Syria, which was Palestine. In other words, after the war, within the popular ranks of the intelligentsia and in the military, the option of Palestine was seen either as being a decentralized part of the Ottoman state, if they won, or if they lost, Palestine would join Egypt in a Khedivian union. Very interesting to hear this discussion today, given that it was not part of the historical discourse which we read about later. Of course, most of these diaries were written by males, by men, but there was a significant number of female authors who left us with diaries and memoirs. Those include Ambar Aslam from Beirut, Kulthum Ode from Nazareth, and Adel Azar from Jaffa. There were many others, but those are the ones that I will refer to. From the Ottoman side, we have the important memoir of Khalid Adib, who was in charge of the Syrian education portfolio under Jamal Pasha's leadership, and she published a very important memoir called Türkün Ateşli İmtihani, which was published in English as The House of Syria, describing her vision for the future of education in Syria. During the war, she became a very important functionary. She was one of the few Turkish officers in the Ottoman army, and she spent much of the war years in Damascus and in Beirut. More interesting is the work of Ambar Aslam, who lived between 1897 and 1986. She came from a family who came from a line of parliamentary and administrative deputies in the Ottoman Empire. Her father was Ali Sulam, a member of Majlis al-Mabuthan. She established her literary career by translating the Odyssey into Arabic. And she was the first woman in Syria, at least as far as I could tell, that publicly removed the veil in 1927. She was part of the Huda Sha'rawi's group of feminists at the time. What is interesting in her memoir is the way in which she was traumatized by the execution and the hanging of her fiancé, Abdul Ghani al-Araisi, a very important patriot from Lebanon, by Jamal Pasha for his nationalist activities in 1915. He was hanged in the famous hangings in Al Burj. She became active during the war for refugee relief in the Ottoman Red Crescent, and later married Ahmed Samih al-Khaldi and moved to Jerusalem, where she wrote her memoirs. Here we have a picture of Ambara with King Faisal and her husband, Ahmed Samih al-Khaldi. I referred also to the work of Arif al-Arif, who was known as Arif Shahade at the time. Lieutenant Arif Shahade was captured in Ardurum in 1915 and spent the war years in Siberia in a Russian encampment for Ottoman soldiers. He relates in his memoirs how he discovered his Arabness in Istanbul while being active in the Muntada al-Arabi, or the Arab Club. He turned against his leadership and the CUP when news arrived of the major hanging of Arab patriots in Cannon Square in Sahat al-Burj in Beirut in August 1916. Was it 16 or 1915? I'm not sure, actually. When he returned to join Prince Faisal in Jabal al-Arab or Jabal al-Druz, he moved back to Syria and then later started publishing a newspaper by a very significant name, Southern Syria, Surya al-Janubi, which was his answer to the attempt by the British and the French to separate Palestine from Syria. That is, by asserting not the independence of Palestine, but the union of Palestine with Syria being the southern part of it. So Surya al-Janubi was published in early 1919 until Arif was became part of the mandate administration of Palestine and then Jordan. He joined the Transjordanian government as secretary of the Ministerial Council in Amman and wrote a very important autobiography, which was just published this last year in Beirut. It's called the Amman Diary, in 1926-1929. Arif was also active in a very important college called Salahiyya, named after Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, which was located first in Jerusalem, then in Damascus. And this college was created by Jamal Pasha, Buyuk Jamal, to establish an intellectual base or pan-Islamic intelligentsia in support of the new Ottomanism, as opposed to the pre-Young Turk state. The Salahiyya attracted some of the best intellectual figures of the period from Palestine, Lebanon, and Syria. Its faculty included its director, Rustam Haydar, who also published a very important autobiography. Haydar was the private secretary of Prince Faisal and then King Faisal. And it included pro-Ottoman teachers such as Abdulaziz Shawish, Adel Jaber, Khalil Sakakini, the educator, and Is'af and Nashashibi. Salahiyya College presented an alternative educational model to the missionary modernist schools and the traditional state Nizamiya schools. Teaching was in Arabic and Turkish. So this was an important college of modernist teaching established by the Ottomans, but also tried to integrate this identity known as Osmanlilik. Here we have a very interesting picture showing, it's the only picture I could find, it's never been published until this year, showing an uprising which took place in Nablus in January of 1918 against the separation of Palestine from Syria and against British occupation of southern Palestine. The Nablus uprising of January 1918 was a desperate move for restoration of Ottoman rule. It was easily defeated with the entry of the British forces to the north in the spring of 1918. Ottoman flags continued to be raised as a marker of the unity of Palestine with Greater Syria throughout the 1920s and 30s. You see, what I'm trying to do so far is to show you that the adoption of Arab separatist Arab nationalism by the Syrian intelligentsia was not a done fact. It was something that evolved over the time and was caused by the ruptures of the First World War. But there was a yearning that continued to be for many decades, both for the continuation of the Ottoman Union on decentralized basis or for the unity of Greater Syria under Damascus. So I will now start to conclude, since I'm getting nasty looks from the moderator.
No.
One conclusion about these memoirs is that they help us understand the fungibility and fragility of borders in the post-World War period. It took several decades for state claims for these boundaries to gel. It also meant that pan-Arabists and later pan-Islamists were not seen as subverting the national legitimacy of the state when they operated across borders, or when they challenged the artificiality of these borders. I'm talking here about the Ba'athists, the Nasserists, as well as the communists in having pan-Arab strategies. You see it also in the diary of Arif al-Arif, in his Amman diary, where he shows that the regime in Amman could not treat dissidents who fought against the regime in favor of Syrian unity as being outside agitators. They were part and parcel of the local intelligentsia, and people crossed the border, continued to cross the border without any respect or adherence to the newly formed colonial borders of the smaller states of the Middle East. Eventually, state boundaries were consolidated in favor of a new tentative legitimacy with the decline of pan-Arabism and Nasserism in the 1960s. The biographic trajectories of the three soldiers which I have discussed suggest rethinking and reinvention of identity, as in the autobiography of Muhammad al-Fasih, whom I did not discuss, or separatist nationalism by Arif Shahadi, or pacifism by Ihsan al-Turjman. I will make here two conclusions from this discussion. First, the reconstruction of identity experienced in the Great War is ephemeral. Self-conceptions transform themselves to ruptures at a very fast rate during times of war, because the war disrupts the tempo of daily routine. It compels us to think or rethink where we were and where we are heading in the immediate future. You can glean this not from the official discourse, but from the diaries and memoirs written. The second conclusion is that when people are faced with devastation, they tend to revert to the comfort and security of local identity, because it is protective and familiar and allows people to insulate themselves from the seeming impending of collapse of the world around them. And this, I think, applies to what happened after the Great War, after the Nakba, and today with the raging of wars in Yemen, in Libya, and especially in Iraq and Syria. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Salim, very much. We will continue now with question and answers. I have in front of me many questions. I'm going to start with simple questions that have a quick answer, and then there are other questions that will take a bit more elaboration. So one person is asking, earlier in your talk, you referred to a division of ethnic national groups made by the Ottomans. And what was the word Rumi refers to? You had Arabs, Turkoman, Rumi. What does it mean, Salim, at the time?
Rumi refers to two things. The Rumli was the western part of the Ottoman state, so that the area of Istanbul and areas west were Rumli, that is the Byzantine part of the Ottoman Empire. And it continued to be used not as a reference to the religion of the adherents, but to the part of Anatolia that was west. And the second meaning of Rumi, which is in this map, refers to the people following the Orthodox Eastern Church. And it includes Armenians, Orthodox Christians from Syria, as well as Greeks. So Rumi was a generic term for all these. Rum in the map for Syria refers to Arab Christians, okay, which includes non-Orthodox Christians also. They use the term in a more extended form.
Another quick question, I think, is what effect did Ataturk's replacement of Turkish script to Latin script of the Turkish language of administration have on Arab language? Was there any effect there?
You mean by the question what effect it had on the Turkish language or on the Arabic language?
No, was on the Arabic language. Was there some kind of a repercussion to the fact that the Turkish language switched from Arabic script to Latin script?
There was some, the major impact was hostility because it reflected within the Turkish population, there was substantial resistance to the loss of heritage because the Latinization of the script meant that huge repertoire of literature, poetry, scientific discourse was no longer accessible by the new generation of Republican Turkish speakers. Within the Arab world, there was some attempts to Latinize the Arabic language, but they were not really successful. There was, I think Said Aqil was one of the few people who called for this within the Arab East. There were few in North Africa. One major success was the Latinization of the Amazigh language, which had its own script, and not to write it in Arabic script, but to write it in Latin script, which was successful. But within the Arab world, Egypt was the only place where there were some minority intellectuals who thought that modernizing culture entailed Latinization of the script. But I think it was a very small minority.
Okay, here's a question which I think would be a bit more substantial. Were there exchanges between the intellectuals of the Mashriq and the Maghrib during that period? Many North Africans were mobilized by the French army to fight alongside them, alongside the French army. Were there also relations, in addition to that, with the Egyptian intellectual of that time? There are two parts in this question. Whether
I'll take with the second part. There was substantial affinities between the modernist intellectual currents in Egypt as well as in the Arab East, partly because Egyptian journalism at the time was heavily penetrated by Shami immigrants who established Al-Hilal, Jurzidan, Taqla with Ahram. I mean, Ahram and Al-Hilal were basically Syrian Shami products. But also the Arab Academy in Cairo was a very influential base competing with the Syrian Academy, but a very much important base for the propagation of modernism in the Arabic language. The Egyptian press, the Egyptian periodicals, and Egyptian publishing, of course, was much earlier than the one in Syria and continued to influence Arab intellectuals. Plus, don't forget, there was a heavy amount of economic relation, trade. Even though Egypt had become independent from the Ottoman Empire, it continued to exert huge influence on the Syrians and vice versa. When the AUB expelled the radicals in 1880, people like Shibli Ismail and Jurzidan went to Egypt and joined their brethren there. With the first part of the question, the short answer is no. There was very little communication between North Africa in the Maghreb countries and the East, except for Al-Azhar attracting a great deal of religious scholars from Algeria and Morocco. And Abdul Qadir Jazairi and others who migrated to the East, remember there were whole sections of Damascus and Jerusalem which contained Maghrebi communities. And these continued to flow for trade and religious reasons, and they carried with them some kind of religious import. But the only case of sustained engagement with North Africa during the war was with Libya, because Libya became the scene of war by the Italians against the Libyan nationalists, against the Libyan community. And Libya became a pivotal issue for the Arabs of the East against the Italian and then French colonial efforts. So there was affinities, but in terms of intellectual discourse, actually there was more rupture than continuity.
Okay, another question, and that could be also substantial, I'm guessing. I'm reading the question. Autobiographical narratives of the same time in Europe referred a lot to traumatizing experiences of the war itself, for example, at the front, which provoked changes in their views about modernity and technology. Does it appear also in the narratives you spoke about, and did it play a role in the question of identity with respect to Western values, for example?
Well, certainly, the first modern autobiography was published in France. The first Arab modern autobiography, Saq al-Saq, Shidyaq was resident in Paris after a sojourn in Tunis and in Malta. He moved to Paris, and to him, Paris was an inspiration not for copying from the French literature, but for revolutionizing and modernizing the Arabic language in its own terms. So Shidyaq writes in a very classical style, but with extremely modernist sensibilities. He must have been influenced very much by his French counterparts. So he read French and Turkish constantly. He also knew Hebrew, Syriac, Akkadian. He knew all the languages of the East because his major task was to translate the Bible to Arabic. And his translation, his modernist translation of Arabic, was rejected by the Catholic Church and by the Orthodox Church because in their eyes it was too Quranic. And that Bible continued to be neglected until 1961, when it was reissued or published and circulated for the first time by the Lebanese Orthodox Church. I think it was published by Balamand, I'm not sure, but it was published in Tripoli. And for the first time, we see this kind of modernist translation of the Bible to Arabic, to modern Arabic. Yeah. So I'm not sure I answered the question, but there certainly was a great deal of communication and influence by people, Tawfiq al-Hakim, Tahsin, thought of the radicalization of the Arabic theater and literature through the lens of their Manfaluti. Many others, Farah Antoun, through the impact of the reading of, especially modern French autobiographical traditions.
Maybe you did not answer the question, but I think you have given us more food for thought here. Thank you on that. Another question, are there class conscious memoirs and memoirs written by lower class Palestinians at the time were socialist idea discussed at all in this context?
I ended my talk before I discussed the issue of class, so that addressed that. I could say that the issue of class was pivotal to several autobiographical works. The most important was by Kulthum Oudeh, who became very prominent in Soviet academia, but she was a feminist writer from Nazareth. She wrote a very important memoir in which class and class conflict, class issues were discussed. But to tell you the truth, aside from the diary of Ihsan al-Turjman, and the later the works of Arab communists from Algeria and from Palestine, there are very few works by artisans or workers. And Ahmed al-Atrash is an exception. I don't know if you consider Najat al-Sudqi a working class person, but he published a communist memoir in the 1940s. But Kulthum Oudeh is the one person I can think of who fits into that. There is, of course, the diary of Ihsan Tujman, who was a common soldier in the Ottoman army. There are quite a few in Turkish, but in Arabic, there are very few.
I think once, Salim, you told me about a Palestinian communist that migrated to the West and was recruited by the Spanish communist during the Spanish Civil War. Do you remember that?
And yeah, you must be thinking of Najat al-Sudqi.
Yes, and yeah. he ended up in some crazy situation where they thought the Republicans in Spain, maybe you can say the story. I mean, they thought he will address the Arab-speaking people in Franco's army to get them to rebel. And this did not happen. I think that I got the story from you. Can you say it more?
Najat al-Sidqi's diary actually is putative, and many people question its authenticity. But Najat al-Sidqi was sent by the Comintern. He was from Jerusalem. He was a functionary in the telegraph department after the war. He was sent by the Comintern to Spain to establish a radio broadcasting to Moroccan soldiers in the Franco regime. And at one point in the Madrid front, he was sent to the front with a loudspeaker, with a battery-operated loudspeaker, and he was addressing the Moroccan crowds with his Palestinian dialects. So they did not understand what he was saying, and they shot at him. And that was the end of his career as a propagator of Arab unity within the fascist community. His work is extremely interesting because it does show the way in which religion and communism operated within the ranks of the Syrian and Palestinian intelligentsia. But it's available now. And we have the diary of another soldier from Spain. There were quite a few, actually. There were several Jewish activists from Palestine who fought in the Spanish Civil War. But there were at least four or five, more than that, from Syria and Palestine. There were about 25 people. Three or four of them wrote diaries or memoirs.
Okay, I have a question myself. What are you working on right now along the lines of your lecture today? Are you anything specific that you may expect in the next 2 years or three?
Well, I just published a book with Hassan Nassar, Stefan Sheehy, called Camera Palestina, which is interpretation of the use of photographs in interpreting social history. And the book is available. You can download it from UC Press.
For how much?
For free. It's a free.
Oh, okay.
That's public domain. You can buy it also in printed form if you have access to Amazon.
Yeah.
I'm working on something which is rather esoteric, but very enjoyable, which is police records from the late 19th century, investigating agitators in peasant communities in central Palestine, in the Jaffa Ramle region.
If, as moderator, I think I have the right to ask another question. One of your books is about the contrast between the coast and the mountain. I mean, the region between, okay, Jaffa, Haifa, and all the way, and the highlands. You did not mention much of that in today's lecture. I found the book, I read it, very interesting. Do these tensions continue to that day, today? I mean, between coast and highlands that have a significance on how Palestinian society is developing? Or maybe this is completely gone.
Well, it's gone because the coast is gone. I mean, the only coastal community left is Gaza. And of course, there is the Palestinian community inside Israel. But the dynamic of social conflict has been completely transformed. In my book, I was talking about the coastal bourgeoisie and the social dynamics between them, which was totally transformed by the war and this dismemberment of Palestine. So now we have a different dynamic, which equally important, but it's a different trajectory. We have rural and urban, we have diaspora and natives, we have state formation and the civil society, people in Bisan, for example, fighting against the hegemony of the Palestinian state apparatus. But I think the main divide now is between a Palestinian diasporan community in the Americas as well as in the camps of the Middle East, and the residue of Palestinian society which remained in Israel, and those who are now under the authority of the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank and in Gaza under Hamas. So it's a completely different trajectories from the one I described in that book.
Yeah. I'm looking at the time, but I'm also looking at the questions that are that were transcribed from the chat box. Another question that is related to the division among Palestinian intellectuals. Could you expand on the tendency to minimize the divisions among Arab intellectuals with respect to the future of the Arab world within the Ottoman Empire? Was it a conscious effort? Who led it? Who else? I think you mentioned some of these people were leading the different faction for Ottoman, the constitutional Ottoman Empire, those who were against. Do you have anything to elaborate on that, Salim, in terms of?
Well, the conflict actually was not between the pro-Ottomans and the pro-Syrian nationalists. It was a conflict within this intelligentsia. I mean, at one point, of course, the pro-Hashemites and the pro-Syrian nationalists began to go different ways. And what is interesting among these people is the manner in which the new state boundaries in the Republic of Syria, the Republic of Lebanon, the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, and the remnants of Palestine began to act within the boundaries of their own state logic. And the countervailing tendency was the emergence of pan-Arabist movements under Nasserism, the Ba'athism, and the work of the communists. So the conflict was no longer between the residues of the Ottomans and the Arab nationalists, but whether you are you're fighting for an Arab identity that transcends these boundaries, or you radicalize the regimes within you live, or you become part of the logic of statehood, which a huge number of succumb to it in the way that Egyptian nationalists succumbed to their own state before that. So the main dynamic was between people who still had a vision of greater Syria, of pan-Arabic nationalism, or of socialism across the boundaries, and between those who became intellectually trapped within the new state boundaries. This was the... And the other point I want to respond to this point is that it's very interesting to see how the pan-Ottomanists, the Osmanlilik people, were transformed. We have very important figures in Shakib Arsalan from Lebanon, very important figure, who was a Druze Arab nationalist, but extremely loyal to the Ottoman idea, and then was transformed by it. People like As'ad Shukeri, who was a strike force on behalf of Istanbul, of the Ottomanists. And he continued to be pro-Ottoman, but was marginalized by the war. And one of the most important intellectuals of this period is Muhammad Izzat Darwazi from Nablus, who was a member of the Committee of Union Progress of the Young Turks. He then later joined the Decentralization Party and became a founding father of the party known as Istiklal. Remember, Istiklal Party was the party of greater Syrian unity. It was the equivalent of Nasserism before Nasser and of Ba'athism before the Ba'ath Party. The Klan Party was very important, and one of its leading lights was Muhammad Izzat Darwazi and Abdul Hadi from Nablus. So these were the dynamics within this conflict of the Syrian intelligentsia.
Okay, I'm watching the clock, and I think we are right on time. We would like to finish in about 2 minutes. So I'm going to first thank Salim very much for your lecture, very fascinating. And then I will also point out, well, we can applaud you first, if you can hear that, Salim. The other thing is that, okay, on the screen, you see the next lecture in the BLS series on October 12, a month from now, we will have Professor Nancy Kenwisher of MIT. She's a professor in the Department of Brain and Cognitive Sciences at MIT. You can go to that webpage and see what will be the topic she's talking about. And as I mentioned at the very beginning, the BLS has one lecture every month. And this season, we're going to have 8 lectures, one every month, typically on a Wednesday in the middle of the month at this time. Thank you very much, everybody who has attended. شكراً للجميع لحضوركم وإلى اللقاء.
Thank you.